So I get the honor of standing between you and the coffee. So let's hope I am not spend too much time on that. So I'm going to talk about the methods for assessing cumulative impact on marine ecosystems. And my co-authors are Geir Ottersen and Gro van der Meeren and Henriune Scholwell.
You're in the audience.
Okay. So at first, Rudd did a survey in 2014 where he asked marine scientists around the world what is the most important research question for ocean governance and sustainability, and he did this online survey and he presented researchers with a short list of research questions that have been identified through different processes and in publications, and he had a response from more than 2,000 scientists from 94 countries, and what was ranked as the single most important question for ocean governance and sustainability was assessing cumulative impacts of multiple stressors. And the reasons for that, we all know, I just repeat it, the oceans are impacted by increasing numbers of factors, and they are having an effect that can't be seen in isolation, and of course that is why we are here doing ecosystem based management, and that is why assessing the impact of multiple of cumulative impact of multiple factors is an important question. And if you look at it, is also known by the audience here, but this is not going to change. The impact on the oceans are probably going to increase. For example, this figure here showing the concentration of CO2 measured at the Manuel Observatory is increasing. There are no signs whatsoever that this increase in CO2 concentration in the atmosphere is going to change. It's increasing, and we have to expect that this is going to continue, and it's going to mean that the impact on the oceans from global change and other factors associated with CO2 increase is going to go on and be stronger in the future. And also, more general, the world population is increasing, which is in many ways going to mean that the impact on the oceans and on the Arctic oceans are going to increase in many ways indirectly caused by increasing populations. So you all know this. I just there to remind ourselves about the background for this cumulative impact question. Okay, so I'm going to discuss what methods we should use to assess cumulative impacts. And I'm going to do that for these two areas, for the Norwegian Sea and the Barents Sea, which are located within the Arctic. And I'm going to discuss two types of methods. One type, which is based on spatially resolved quantitative indexes, and another approach, which is based on qualitative assessment of combined effects of single factor impacts. Those are two very different ways to assess cumulative impacts. Okay, so I will look first at the spatially explicit quantitative indexes. There are several types that have been developed. Kolpinen did an evaluation of which of these were most suited to assess the impact, the combined impact of several factors. And his conclusion was that a method that has been developed in the Harmony project was best suited. His assessment was based on many criteria. I will not go into the detail of that. These different methods, they all share some same basic features that I'm going to discuss, but I'm going to use Harmony as an example, but the things I'm going to discuss applies for all these spatially explicit quantitative indexes. Okay, so let's look at the harmony. Harmony is based on assessing cumulative impact individually for different grids, spatial grids on the map. So for each grid, impact I is estimated as the sum of so I is the impact value index within the grid cell. So PI is the estimated value of pressure number I. So there are many different pressures within that are found within the cell. It can be fisheries, it can be pollution, it can be ocean acidification, etc. So all these different pressures, they are estimated. And then the presence or absence of ecosystem components, which is E, in that cell, is you have data on that or you model it. And then there is a weight score, which is mu yj, which is the weight score for pi on ej, which is how severe effect does this p, this pressure, have on that ecosystem E. Okay? So that is estimated for all individual pressure and ecosystem combinations within each cell. And then that is summed up across all pressures and all ecosystem components within the cell. And then you get the sum of the total impact index value for each grid cell. So that's how these indexes operate. Okay? And the pressure and the ecosystem components, you have data or you model those. Whereas the weight scores are done by expert evaluations. So experts are asked to score how serious do we think the impact of this pressure is on this component of the ecosystem. Okay. So that's the basics of this method. And this this equation here was originally published by Benjamin Halpern in his paper in Science on impact on the world ocean by anthropogenic activities and the variation in impact across the globe on all world oceans. So this so all these systems they are actually building on this paper by Benjamin Halpern. Okay, so in Harmony, the Harmony project, which was done for the North Sea, there was data or model data on human uses and land-based pollution. So pressures, 33 different pressures. There were spatial data or model spatial data on 21 ecosystem components. And there were 53 experts that were asked to rank, to assess the impact of how a pressure, any given pressure, what impact it had on these different ecosystem components. So based on this, the index was calculated, and here you see the result. So this based on this suggests that the total impact, cumulated impact, is highest here in the southeastern part of the North Sea, and then it gets smaller, and out here in the middle it's much lower. There are some higher impact up here and then lower again here. Okay. So that's the result from those indexes, which suggest how the total impact is distributed in an ocean area. Okay, so we are going now to revise the ecosystem and management plan for the Barents Sea, and in that process we have gone through these methods. And then we have come up with some critique towards the harmony, to the harmony approach, which then also applies to the other, other spatially resolved quantitative indexes. And just putting up here the equation, so we have that here. And then the first thing concerns the weight scores. So here you have the weight score. It's scored on five different levels, from 0 to 4. So 0 is no impact, and 4 is high peak impact, as scored by the experts. So the impact that the pressure have on the ecosystem component. And here is, on the y-axis, we have plotted...
Is this not working anymore?
Okay. On the y-axis, we have plotted the real impact, the impact that the pressure really have on the ecosystem component in question. And because these weight scores, they are categorical data, but they are used as quantitative data in this equation. And if you're going to use that, you have to assume that there is a linear relationship between the two with a slope of 1. So that if you have 3 impacts with 1, it should be equal to 1 impact scored as 3. But we do not know if we do have this linear relationship. We might have a relationship like this, that if it's scored like 4, it's really serious, but if it's scored like 1, it's not that much, and if you add up many scores that are assigned 1, 4 scores assigned 1 is much less than 1 score assigned 4. So if you have this linear relationship in this way, then you are actually overestimating impact if you have many pressures with a low impact, compared to if you have 1 with a large impact. But we do not know this relationship. So that introduces some uncertainty. Second, the assumption here is that cumulative effects are additive. So the effects are added on top of each other, and they don't interact in any way. Crane did a paper in Ecology Letters some years ago, where he went through a lot of experiments that had been done to assess the combined effects of 2 factors or 3 factors on on ecosystem components in marine ecosystems. And in this study, he found that effects could be additive, synergistic, or antagonistic. And they were all quite common. So the assumption of additive effects is not very well supported by experiments that have been done. And also, if you look at experiments where 3 factors have been combined, you found that they were synergistic in 75% of the experiments. So it seems like the more factors you add, the more they get synergistic, and that's probably why what we have in real life in the oceans. So it might be that synergistic effects are very common, and in that case. An important assumption here is not valid. Okay, 3, you may have lack of spatially resolved data on precision components, or you may have errors in model data. So often you have to model this data and you make assumptions, and these assumptions might sometimes be wrong, of course, and then you might get some errors in your data there. And then 4, impact can occur elsewhere than the pressures. So for example, in this, so the impact on fisheries, they are plotted in the cells where the fishing is actually occurring. Whereas the effect of fishing can occur other places than where the fishing occurs, because fish stocks, they migrate. So if you fish your fish population here, and then it migrates to here and it spawns, and the juveniles, they grow up here, the impact might occur over here. So that introduces some important problems with identifying in space where the impact is actually occurring from an activity. So in conclusion, Our worry is we might have biased estimates. And there are also other problems, like the data. The more pressure data you have for an area, the higher impact you will get. And based on the data that you the amount of data that you add into your estimate can also bias the estimate, which is actually related to this 0.32, the data that you have. So there are a number of reasons that we are worried about biased estimates in these spatially explicit quantitative indexes. Okay, so if we look at this again, we are skeptical to the to this estimate that are given in this plot. And also, if you look at this is another example of application of a very similar approach to the Baltic Sea, where you have the same thing. You have you can see here, you have in the southwestern part you have high impact according to the estimates, also close to in the Finnish Gulf, etc. As you see, these two are overlapping in this area, and then you can of course ask, what do they give in this area? Do they give the same? Oh, okay, 5 minutes left. Same estimate. Make a long story short, there are some very important discrepancies. Some areas with high impact in one model give the lowest impact in the other. So they don't agree very well, these two methods. Okay, the qualitative assessment is based on, you assess the state of the ecosystem, which is, we look specifically what elements are in bad condition, and of course it's you need to have reference points and things to define what's in bad condition, but so I'll leave that in, don't go into details of that, but you know what I mean, you estimate the system and what things are in unwanted or bad condition. You evaluate how pressures can impact the ecosystem, so we go through all the pressures that you have in the system and you evaluate how can they impact this ecosystem, and preferably based on peer review studies. And then you evaluate qualitatively how pressures may be responsible for elements in bad condition. And I will go through an example of this, which was done for the North Sea when ecosystem and management plan was established for the North Sea a few years ago. So the North Sea is found in the south here of this area. It has, there are more, it's impacted by more anthropogenic factors than the Norwegian Sea and the Barents Sea. It's a more complicated area. So what we do first, you assess the state of the ecosystem. So we go through all the components that you have, plankton, bentos, etc. You use your indicators and other information you have. You assess their state. Then you go through all the pressures you have and you assess how can these pressures impact these different components. And then you combine this, and then you do a qualitative assessment based, like when you are discussing research finding, how do human activities impact this ecosystem? How may these different factors be responsible for what we observe as a state in the ecosystem? Then you might also be interested in how may anthropogenic activities impact the system in the future, and that's of course then of course you come into the question of risk of acute impact from pollution, which can occur in the future. Then you can assess what is the risk of acute impact from different factors, from petroleum activities, from ship traffic, etc., on the different components in the ecosystem. You can also go up to this table 2, potential impact of pressures, and you can assess how is this going to develop in the future. And then you can assess how may humans impact the ecosystem in the future. And then all these things together, they will tell you what does management need to consider. What are the anthropogenic activities that can have unwanted impact in the ecosystem that we need to consider. And examples from North Sea, bottom impact of trawling, other bycatch, introducing species with ships, oil spills for petroleum activities, marine litter, etc. Those are issues that were identified as important to consider for the future. Okay. And then we also have maps for some of these, which can tell us how are these risk distributed, how are these problems distributed in space. This is trawling activity, it's petroleum installations, and it's ship traffic. Okay. So conclusions for the Barents and Norwegian Seas. Norwegian and the Barents Seas is a less complicated impact pictures than the Norwegian Sea. Limited number of important pressures. Climate change, fishing, important. And then possibly ocean acidification and pollution can also have some importance. Lack of spatially resolved data in these areas. We have some, but not for all we need. Thus, there is limited gains from harmony approach, and there are potential problems with biased estimate from harmony approach. And therefore, our conclusion is that we are better served with the qualitative assessment that I described in the last part here. Also, I just want to mention briefly the regional integrated ecosystem assessment ISIS groups that are operational for the areas in question, and which are going to work with the question of how do humans impact the ecosystem, and which can give these groups can give important input to when we are within the Norwegian management plan work going to assess the cumulative impact on multiple stressors. Okay, I think I spent my time. Thank you.